Well, good morning. Today we celebrate mothers. Charles Spurgeon writes, "You are as much serving God and looking after your children and training them up in God's fear and minding the house and making your household a church for God as you would have been if you had been called to lead an army to battle for the Lord of hosts." Motherhood in many ways today in today's culture is being attacked. And I want to encourage all the young mothers here today. God has designed motherhood as part of his greater plan to draw people to himself. When thinking about the importance of a mother, we can look in scripture and find the wonderful story of Eunice and Lois, Timothy's mother and grandmother. It was their faith, their commitment to teach him the scriptures, that they played a key role in equipping him for his ministry and life. And Paul references their legacy. We see their legacy when he thanks God for Timothy for his faith. Paul reminds his friend that he has faith first, that his faith lived first in his grandmother and then his mother. Listen to 2 Timothy 1:5. "Now, I am sure," talking to Timothy, that same faith as your mother dwells in you." Then later, Paul encourages Timothy during his persecution for following Christ to stay strong in the word and not to be deceived. Listen to these words in verse 14. "You, however, must continue in the things you have learned and become convinced of, knowing from where you have learned them, your mother, and that from childhood you have known the sacred writings, which are able to give you the wisdom that leads to salvation through faith, which is in Jesus Christ." And then Paul writes later some of the most memorable verses in scripture. 2 Timothy 3:16, "All scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work." Timothy's mother had used the scriptures, which at that time was the Old Testament, to teach, to reprove, to correct, and to train her son, and he grew in righteousness. Mothers, thank you. Thank you for teaching your children, reproving them, correcting them, and training them, raising them in the admonition of the Lord, and we truly pray that you are blessed this day. And speaking of children, we have a lot more running around here, which means that we need a lot more workers in the nursery. Sarah Hayden and Christian have put some sign-up sheets out in the narthex, so if you're willing to tackle that responsibility to allow some of these young mothers to come and worship, please make the effort to sign up on those sheets or email me at the office if you'd like. Two other quick announcements. You might have seen a Samaritan's purse truck out here in the parking lot. Rick Carter and Paul Thompson went to get it yesterday, so we now have our Samaritan's Purse truck, and we're going to open it up for viewing on the picnic day. So we'll open it up and let people take a walk through there and understand a little bit more about how that whole process is going to work, with Grace being a lighthouse church for Samaritan's Purse. One other short announcement: Wednesday nights, in 2 weeks, Dr. Jacob starts a series on Timothy, and then followed up by Titus, the pastoral epistles. Christian will finish up this week on his teaching of the Westminster Confession and the Lord's Prayer. So please put those on your calendars and begin to come. So if you're a visitor for the first time, we're so glad you're here. Please take the Grace Connect card in front of you in the bullet, in the pew, and complete it. If you need to have your information changed, if you've already in Grace Connect, please send me an email and we'll correct that. So as you'll hear from Dr. Jacobs later this morning, Caesar minted coins as he had a right to do, and he demanded some coins in return. He had the right to do so. After all, it was his image that was stamped on what he had made. God has minted the human soul, and he has stamped his image on every one of us. So he gave Caesar his due, the temporary stuff of the word of the world, but make sure to give God his due. So now please stand as we for our call to worship. Let us join our voices to praise the spotless Lamb, Jesus Christ, who has redeemed us from sin and death. We who have been redeemed will sing praises and shout for joy this hour. Because of Christ, the Lamb, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our sins, in accordance with the riches of his grace. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. Let us praise him by saying, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb we give worship this hour and forever and ever. Amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
The new apostolic reformation spreading in churches around the world is trying to dismantle the foundation of Christianity. It's a movement that replaces the Word of God with experiences and feelings. The emphasis is on signs and wonders and elevates man. Instead of being sober-minded, they become drunk in the Spirit. Instead of Bible studies, they have supernatural schools of ministry where they can learn to pay for the gifts of God. Instead of being taught, be ye separate from the world, they learn to accept the occults in the name of tolerance, slap a Jesus label on it, and say, I can make it on my own. The Word of God is the only weapon we have to stand against these heresies. In the year 325, the church faced a heresy related to the nature of Christ. Arius believed wrongly that God the Father was eternal and uncreated and that Jesus was created. But Athanasius challenged Arius, questioning that if Christ is not eternally God, then how could it be right to worship him? How can his death and resurrection save us if he's not in fact the eternal Son? The result of this debate was the Nicene Creed, which we will read in just a moment. Historical creeds and confessions are letters from Christians who come before us, warning us against theological errors. These Christians relied on Scripture as the ultimate authority, and if something was contrary to Scripture, then it could not stand. So now let us profess what we believe about our Trinitarian God. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, begotten from the Father for all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of the same essence as the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. He became incarnate by the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and he was made human. He was crucified for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. The third day he arose from, according to the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again with glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will never end. And we believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, giver of life. He proceeds from the Father and the Son, and with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified. He spoke through the prophets. We believe in the one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We affirm one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look forward to the resurrection of the dead and to life in the world to come. Amen.
Oh,
come to our time of confession, the very stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Please be seated. Sorry about that. Sorry. It's been a long morning, hadn't it? The very stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Come now to Christ, the living stone, a cornerstone chosen and precious. Whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. Trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ, let us now confess our sins before God and before one another. Almighty God, we confess how hard it is to be your people. You have called us to be the church, to continue the mission of Jesus Christ to our lonely and confused world. Yet we acknowledge we are inactive, isolated, involved, callous and compassionate, obstinate and obedient, legalistic and loving. Gracious Lord, have mercy upon us and forgive our sins. Remove the obstacles preventing us from being your representative to a broken world. Awaken our hearts to the promise of your indwelling spirit. This we pray in Jesus' powerful name. Amen. In Romans 5:8 and Colossians and Romans, Paul is very adamant about the concept of assurance of our prayers being answered. And he says in these verses, God demonstrates his love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness. And he's brought us into the kingdom of the Son that he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. And therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus taught us to pray this prayer. Let's read it together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Before the world began. Good morning, church, and happy Mother's Day to all of you ladies. When I think of mothers, I can't help but think of my own. My mom was born in Covington, Kentucky. She was raised by very legalistic religious people that turned her off to the faith. She was a beautiful woman, Irish, black hair, blue eyes, somehow ended up in Miami, became Miss Coral Gables. She was a looker. Married my father, and in the course of time found out that my father was violent. So she fled with me as a young child. We moved to Los Angeles, California, broke as possibly could be. My mom worked as a PBX operator on the top story of the largest, tallest building in Los Angeles called the Crocker Bank Building. She took three or four buses every morning to get there. I was a latchkey kid, literally, with a piece of yarn around my neck and the key to the house door to get back in when school had ended. We were poor. We took buses everywhere. We were poor, but I never knew it. She would take us on trips, use his buses. We'd go to Chinatown and Alvera Street in Los Angeles, the Mexican quarters. She made life an adventure. When I was 15 years old, she clearly had terminal cancer. I never knew it. Came home one day, and she was gone. Actually, the neighbors took me to Pasadena Hospital, where I entered a room, and my mom was on life support. The next day, I would get a call to find out that my mom had passed away. I never knew she was sick as she was sick. She never complained, and she was sick, clearly. That's what I think of motherhood. That's what I think about mother. Her love was unconditional. When I did something wrong, I might have been afraid of the police, the principal, the teachers. I was more afraid of my mom. She loved me unconditionally. She made life grand. It was always sunny, never doomy, never gloomy. She had every reason in the world to vent about my father, to complain. She never did. That's what I think of mothers. And I married someone just like my mother. So, because I'm pastor, I get to do that. Thank God for you mothers. You make the world go round. Amen? Okay. If you're new to our church, that doesn't happen all the time, by the way. But we are continuing our study of Mark chapter 12, and I encourage you to find your way there with me if you would. And I will say this before we get to the text. Today, for years, how I wish, how I would, how I long to have had the opportunity to share the gospel, the true gospel of grace, with my mother. And I'm saying to all of you, whoever it is in your life and in your heart and in your family and in your world, don't wait. If you have the opportunity today, don't wait, because you may not tomorrow. Amen? Mark chapter 12, we'll be looking at verses 13 through 17. If you found your way there, would you join me as we stand together for the reading of God's holy, inerrant, and infallible word? Verse 13, then they sent some of the Pharisees and Herodians to him, to Jesus. Why? In order to trap him in a statement. And they came and said to him, Teacher, we know that you are truthful and defer to no one, that you are not partial to any, but teach the way of God in truth. Question, is it lawful to pay a poll tax to Caesar or not? Shall we pay it or shall we not pay it? But he, knowing their hypocrisy, said to them, Why are you testing me? Bring me a denarius to look at. And they brought one, and he said to them, Whose likeness and inscription is this? And they said to him, Caesar's. And Jesus said to them, Render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. And they were amazed at him. Let's pray together. Our God and our Father, we're grateful for this time in your word. Grateful for this opportunity to set our minds upon the things that really matter. We pray, God, that you, by your Spirit, would help us to tune out and tune in to what you have to say to us. We pray that you would give us eyes to see, that you would give us ears to hear you, that you would give us hearts that are soft, tender, and ready to receive your truth. We do pray for the one who preaches, his sins, like all of ours, are many, hide him in the shadow of Christ, that we might see and hear Jesus. We pray this morning that we would not just be challenged by his words, but changed, not just confronted, but conformed to the image of the one who spoke them. And we ask these things in Christ's name, and all God's people said, amen. You may be seated. In July of last year, we began our study of Mark's gospel. That's not bad, because I think by this July, we'll have reached the 14th chapter. What are you laughing about? 14 chapters in 1 year, that's not bad. Back then in my introduction, I suggested to you that many scholars see the Gospel of Mark as an oral text, a written account of Jesus that was meant to be read out loud, that Mark is a written work to be read to a listening audience. And as such, one of the many ways in which Mark helps the listener is that he tells the story of Jesus in just three phases. Each of these phases corresponds to geographical locations. And as such, stage one was Jesus in and around the Galilee, chapter 1 through chapter 8. Stage two was Jesus away from the Galilee on the road towards Jerusalem, chapter 8 to chapter 10. And then finally, third stage, Jesus in Jerusalem, chapter 11 through chapter 16. And that's where we are, Jesus in Jerusalem. With the entrance of Jesus into Jerusalem, chapter 11, this final journey has reached its destination. The final stage has begun. And Jesus in Jerusalem will dominate the remainder of Mark's gospel, from chapter 11 all the way through the end of the gospel in chapter 16. So Mark's gospel ends with six chapters of Jesus' words and Jesus' works in Jerusalem. And if I could provide you an outline of where we are, what we will be looking at over the next remaining weeks and months, basically these six chapters break down into five general categories. Each of these five general categories contain four events. So last week's number one category, signs for Jerusalem, with four elements. Number one, four elements. The colt we've looked at, the temple we've looked at, the withering of the fig tree we've looked at, as well as fourth, the cleansing of the temple. That's category number one, 4 points. Category number two, which we started and we're looking at today, is confrontations. Confrontations between Jesus and Israel's spiritual leadership. About his authority, which we've already looked at. This morning, about taxes. Number three, about the resurrection, which will come from the Sadducees. And number four, about the great commandment. That's category number two. First, signs for Jerusalem. Two, confrontations, each containing four subtitles, sublets. Number three will be his teaching. We've looked at one of them thus far. That's the parable of the vine grower. We will also have Christ as the Son of David, number two. Number three, a lesson about the widow's mite. And number four, a great message on his coming and the end of the world. Number four, signs about himself. Four again, his anointing, his betrayer, his body and blood, and his denier. And the fifth are events. All of those lead to events. Signs for Jerusalem, confrontations, his teachings, signs concerning himself. The fifth is events, four of them again. His arrest, his trials, his crucifixion, and his burial and resurrection. Five major categories, signs for Jerusalem, confrontations, his teaching, signs about himself, and finally, the closing events, his passion. That will unfold in the remaining chapters of Mark's gospel. This morning, we're returning to confrontations. And again, as Jesus arrives in Jerusalem, he finds himself In the midst of sustained conflicts, literally an onslaught of conflict with the leadership. And if you're like me, I hate conflict. I hate conflict. It's one of the hardest things about being a pastor is dealing with conflict. And yet, Jesus finds himself in the midst of prolonged, persistent conflicts, verbal conflicts about the truth. And what's interesting is this, and that is that the entire history of Christianity is really, listen to me, is defined by conflict. Beginning with Jesus and on to this day, our history as believers and followers of Christ has been defined by conflict. But believe it or not, that's not a bad thing. Why do I say that? I say that because we find not only in Scripture, but then in subsequent history, that conflict is often the way in which the truth is identified. Truth claims are identified often because of conflict. Truth claims need to be carefully articulated because of the rise of conflict. Because of conflict, truth claims are often clarified. Truth claims demand our otherwise indifference, demands our attention because of conflict. Truth claims are wrestled with, grasped, studied by a larger audience than normally would be the case, all because of conflict. For instance, if you know your New Testament, you know that virtually the entire New Testament is made up of truth claims. Truth claims that take the spotlight because of conflicts. Many of the books that make up the New Testament were written because of conflicts. Peter, Paul, James, John, all of them writing because of conflict. Conflicts about theological issues, ethical issues, personal issues, practical issues, conflicts. Paul's life, literally, the Pauline epistles are written as apologetics to be spoken to address conflicts in the newborn church. And these truth claims take the spotlight because of conflict. And often these conflicts occur with the powers that be. That was true for the Old Testament prophets, often set to the kings, the high priests, so forth. Certainly true for Jesus, certainly true for the apostles, certainly true for the reformers. Just listen and finish Michael Reeves, professor at Union Theological School in Wales, England, on a series he did on the English Reformation. All those kings and queens that vacillate between hardcore Roman Catholicism and Reformed truths, Protestantism, men that died, women that died, set on fire, beheaded, conflict after conflict after conflict. And it is true for the church today. And you can believe me, it's going to become more real to you before the Lord takes you from here. Conflict. As Jesus arrives in Jerusalem, on this final stage of his redemptive work, Jesus and Jerusalem's leaders again are in conflict, and these conflicts unfold before a watching crowd. Sustained conflicts about truth before an audience. That's what's taking place here. Just look at chapter 11 and identify kind of this bombardment with me, just briefly. Notice verse 13. Then they sent some Pharisees and Herodians to him in order to trap him in a statement. Conflict. See it again in verse 18. Some Sadducees, who say there's no resurrection, came to Jesus, began questioning him. Conflict. Verse 28. One of the scribes came and heard them arguing and recognized that he had answered them well and asked. Conflict. One after the other, bombardment. Just standing there, can't get away from where he's standing because one after the other, after the other, after the other is confronting him. This morning, we're looking at one of those confrontations. And I want to make a few points. The first point I will call the evil of spiritual semantics. Look at verse 13. Then they sent some Pharisees and Herodians to him in order, listen to this, to trap him in a statement. When I say spiritual semantics, I'm referring to their obvious disingenuous intentions. These leaders are not in the least bit interested in what Jesus is actually saying. They're only interested in semantics, trying to find words that can be used against Jesus, finding words from Jesus in order to accommodate their agenda, to accommodate their unbelief, their rejection, just semantics. And I've had many conversations with people that are only interested in the semantics, not interested in the truth, their soul, the gospel, just semantics. And for them, these leaders, the truth has been reduced down to nothing more than an evil, disingenuous word game, trying to find words. And you'll notice in verse 14, when they come to him, they refer to Jesus as teacher. That's purposeful. Why teacher? Because what do teachers do? They teach. And how do teachers teach? They teach by using words. They call Jesus teacher. They ask a question, wanting Jesus to teach, wanting Jesus to use words, words with which they can catch him, snag him, trap him. They want to condemn him with his words. They listen to Jesus, listen to this, for one reason. And that is to catch him saying something that can be used against him. What's remarkable is that being the case, it never stopped Jesus from teaching. And the hypocrisy of these men is thick. Verse 14, they come to him, teacher, we know that you are truthful. They don't believe that. And defer to no one. They don't believe that. For you are not partial to any. They don't believe that. But teach the way of God and truth. They don't believe that. But isn't it ironic that their phony flattery is really the truth, isn't it? Jesus is everything they in their phoniness say is true. Jesus is always perfectly truthful. What a lesson for all of us. Jesus never vacillated depending on his circumstance, his audience, the popular expectation, whether there was danger or whether there was honor at stake. He never vacillated. Jesus only taught one thing, and that was God's word. He did so unflinching and yet with compassion. But for these leaders, it's just a word game, a gotcha. Jesus would often say, he who has an ear, let him hear. These leaders are listening, obviously, with ears that cannot and do not hear. That's point one. Second point, not only the evil of spiritual semantics, which any of us can find ourselves employing dangerously, but secondly, the issue of the poll tax. Notice verse 14b and 15a. And so they asked Jesus, here's the question, is it lawful to pay a poll tax to Caesar or not? Shall we pay or shall we not pay? There is more than meets the eye to their question. A little history. Maybe you remember the name Pompey. Pompey was the famous Roman general and statesman who most famously transformed Rome from a republic to an empire. Pompey, during the last years of the Roman Republic before becoming an empire, brought Israel, ancient Israel, under Rome's control in 63 BC. And from that point on, the nation of Israel ceased to be an independent kingdom, and Israel became ruled by client kings of Rome, like Herod the Great. In AD 6, Rome moved from using vassal kings and began to rule over occupied ancient people like Israel directly. And they did so by Ruling over land using Roman governors or procurators, Pilate would be an example of such a person. Why is that important? Because it is at this point that Rome began to impose this annual poll tax. The poll tax demanded one denarius. Hang there, and I'll get to that in a minute. A denarius was equal to an average of one day's wage. Whatever you make in a day, that would be your poll tax. And this denarius that was required by Rome was to be paid by these Jewish people using a specific Roman coin minted by Rome. This tax, this poll tax, was levied on every Jew from puberty to age 65. Every year, from puberty to age 65, Rome required every Jew subjugated by them to pay this annual tax. And it wasn't the amount. I mean, one day's wage is a lot, but it wasn't the amount per se. This poll tax had several intentions. One is it reminded this people, this subjugated people, i.e. Israel, of Rome's conquest over them. Every year, Rome's conquest over them was literally rubbed in their face because of this poll tax. Roman citizens were exempt from the poll tax. The poll tax was levied on those whom Rome had conquered and now occupy. So every year again, puberty to 65, you had to pay this poll tax, and in so doing, you acknowledged being a subjugated, conquered people. A second reason is that this poll tax forced these conquered Jews to somehow more than acknowledge, less than worship, but somewhere in between, to acknowledge Rome and Caesar. The Romans called this poll tax a tributum, or a tribute. Paying this poll tax is a way of forcing the Jews literally to pay tribute to Rome, to pay tribute to Caesar, which they despised. And thirdly, this poll tax was exactly that. It was a poll tax. It was Rome's way of counting heads. Today, people take polls. In doing so, they count heads. Here, this poll tax, Rome was counting heads, counting the heads of subjugated people. It was literally a way of conducting a population census, counting those people who were under their control. And altogether, this poll tax symbolize Rome's conquest, their dominance, their subjugation, and ultimately the humiliation of ancient Israel. The poll tax obviously was deeply resented. It was inaugurated again in AD 6. Immediately after its inauguration, to give you a bit of its history, after it was inaugurated, the poll tax, the Jews revolted, history tells us, led by a man named Judas of Galilee. It was bloody. Eventually, Rome stop the uprise. But this poll tax, by the way, according to Josephus, led to the rise of the Jewish zealots, and ultimately, years later, would lead to the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70. Serious stuff. When these leaders asked Jesus, is it lawful to pay a poll tax to Caesar or not? Shall we pay it or not? It is impossible for me to overstate how explosive this issue was. You see, the poll tax wasn't just about taxes. It wasn't just about politics, military conquests, and the like. But it was also extraordinarily theological. Again, this annual poll tax that every Jew, puberty to 65, paid had to be a specific Roman minted silver coin. That coin was called, technically, a denarius. You couldn't pay with any other currency but with a denarius. And this Roman minted silver cord, i.e. the denarius, on one side, it bore the facial portrait of Tiberius Caesar. along with, underneath it, his official title, which said this, son of the divine Augustus, his father. In other words, here's Tiberius Caesar's face with the claim that he is the son of Augustus, the god. On the other side, there was an image of Tiberius' mother named Livia, who in this depiction is seated on a throne, posed as the goddess daughter of Jupiter named Pax, P-A-X. In one hand, she is holding a scepter. In the other hand, she is holding a bouquet of flowers. And around that image is the words Pontifex Maximus, which is translated our high priest. That was really offensive to the Jews. This poll tax was altogether blasphemous. It was the violation of the second commandment, thou shalt have no graven images. The coin depicted the deification of human beings. And they come to him again with the question, verse 14, 15a, teacher, we know that you are truthful, defender of no one, you're not partial to any, but teach the way of God and truth. Here it is. Is it lawful to pay a poll tax to Caesar or not? Shall we pay or shall we not pay? When these Jewish leaders come to Jesus, they come to him with what they believe to be the single question. That single question that no matter how Jesus answers, whether yes or no, they got him. Yes, pay it, or no, don't pay it. Yes, pay it, the Jews will reject him. No, don't pay it, Rome will kill him in opposition against Rome. And at the end of verse 15a, literally as a reader, we're left in pensive anticipation. What will Jesus say? No win question. How will he answer this? Brings me to my third point. The conspiracy of word, the issue of poll tax. Third, the question of image. Verse 18. But Jesus perceived their malice and said, why are you testing me, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the poll tax. And they brought him a denarius. And he said to them, whose likeness and inscription is this? And they said to him, Caesar's. And then he said to them, here's the answer. Then render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. You need to know that because of the nature of this Roman silver denarius, the Jews of Jesus' day didn't use them. You get that. The Jews of Jesus' day used locally minted, Jewish minted copper coins, like the ones that the widow throws into the collection container. The Jews of Jesus' day, because of the nature of this Roman coin, didn't own them, didn't carry them, didn't exchange them. They were seen as blasphemous, wouldn't touch one. However, monetarily, this silver denarius was of more value than any other coin at that time. And it's clear from the text, Jesus didn't have one of these coins. Disciples didn't have one of these coins. Although, you do know that Judas, in a little bit, will be paid 30 of these Roman denarius coins for betraying Jesus. But guess what? Verse 15b and 16a, but he, knowing their hypocrisy, said to them, why are you testing me? Bring me a denarius to look at. And they brought him one. Everybody got that? Say, oops. Jesus didn't have one. Disciples didn't have one. God-fearing Jews would never have one. But guess what? These hypocritical Jewish leaders, they've got one. Everybody got that? Reminds me of many years ago, standing on a flight line, San Antonio, Texas, in the Air Force, pitch dark, 4 or 5 a.m., for physical training. And one of the many rules was that you couldn't wear your watch during physical training. And one morning in that dark, some drill instructor stuck his hat in my forehead, you know how that is, and said, Jacobs, what time is it? And without thinking, I looked down and looked at my watch and told him the time. And what he said next, I can't repeat. Jesus says, bring me one. Whoops, they've got one. And without thinking, one of them reaches into his pocket and hands Jesus this blasphemous but valuable Roman silver denarius. It's hypocrisy. Again, verse 16, they brought one. He said to him, whose likeness and inscription is this? And they said to him, Caesar's. And Jesus said to them, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's and to God the things that are God's. And they were amazed at him. How did he get out of this question? But what began as a single question, a gotcha question? Yes, the Jews will reject Jesus. No, Rome will reject Jesus. Turns out to be occasion, does it not, for one of Jesus' most well-known sayings. Render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's and to God the things that are God's. What does that mean, really? What does that mean? Well, on the front end, Jesus is saying, simple understanding, that obeying government, even if it's oppressive and godless, isn't necessarily setting oneself against God. Everybody got that? So what Paul will articulate in Romans 13, that every person is to be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except God, and those that exist, exist and are established by God. Therefore, don't resist this authority. Not only will Paul deal with that, but Peter in 1 Peter 2, submit yourself for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether a king as one authority or governors sent by him for the punishment of evildoers. In other words, as Christians, we don't have permission to resist government until it reaches a point. Essentially, there is no authority that isn't established by God, whether it's really good or really bad. Why? Because God is sovereign, and we are not. And God purposes these authorities in ways that we may not understand. No matter where our country goes, our government goes, I get it. But you need to remind yourself, I need to remind myself, God is still on the throne. And God has a purpose, always has a purpose. We are submit to the political because our mission isn't political. Our mission is spiritual. We submit to the political so that we can get on with the spiritual. But deeper to this question is the issue of image. When he says to them, whose likeness or whose image in inscription is this? And they said to him, Caesar's. If we leave the issue of inscription alone for a minute and we focus on the question of image, when they say the image is Caesar's, are they correct? Yes. Are they perfectly correct? No. Because ultimately, anyone, even someone as godless as Tiberius Caesar, every human being is, in fact, the image of God. Are you concerned about our nation? If so, raise your hand. Just curious. We're concerned about a lot that's going on in our country, going on in the world. LGBTQ issues, transgender issues, racial issues, abortion issues, war, Russia, Ukraine. We could go on and on. Crime, people killing each other. But I'm going to suggest to you that there is a simple cause for every one of these problems, every one of them, universally. And the cause of every one of these issues that concerns us, every one of them, stems from the most fundamental question that humanity faces. And that is this: what does it mean to be a human being? What does it mean to be a human being? I, John Jacobs, am a human being. What does that mean to me? You look at me, I'm Pastor John. Pastor John's a human being. What does that mean to you? Who am I? Why am I? What am I? The human race has lost its understanding of what it means to be a human being. Several years ago, in an article that appeared in a newspaper was titled, "The Irony of Being Human." The irony of being human in this article involves two different stories that took place at the same location. The first story was about a woman in her late 20s. She had the day before left her husband, her home, her children, her job, and everything in order to run off with another man. And they met in a particular hotel downtown and spent the night. The next morning, the man woke up and told her that he was returning to her wife and left her in that hotel. She, realizing that she had lost everything. She had lost her family, her reputation, her husband, her job. She had lost everything in a moment. In utter despair, she reached into her purse, pulled out a gun, and took her life. The reporter that wrote this article was told by the police that there was a note on the nightstand that she wrote these words, her final words, "Don't cry for me, for I'm not even human anymore," end quote. The irony comes from the second story. In that same hotel, on that very same night, at the very same hour that this woman took her life, there was a meeting downstairs in the convention center. A meeting of what we used to call New Agers. And the meeting ended with a celebrity New Ager that you'd know, but I won't mention her name, why, giving a speech, and at the end of her talk, she had everyone stand up, stand on their chairs, lift their hands in the air, and together in unison begin shouting, "I am God, I am God, I am God." The irony. From a woman floors above who says, "I'm not even human anymore, not worth living, not worth a life," to people so delusioned below her shouting in unison, "I am God." That's our world. We live in a world that doesn't understand what it is to be human. People who act as if they're God, choose to end lives and destroy lives, from cities and populations to nations to an unborn child to the streets. And people who don't see any dignity in others or themselves. It is really the greatest problem our world, human beings not knowing what it means to be a human being. I'm reminded of David in Psalm 8. He says this, "What is man that thou take thought of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than God and crowned him with glory and majesty." Whose likeness is on this coin? Caesar. Caesar. And that's a problem. That's a problem. Because it's not just the image of Caesar, it's also the image of who? Of God. I mean, if anything, this incident in the life of Christ ought to cause us all to think about putting on a different set of spectacles. Where no matter who I look at, whether I look in the mirror at myself, or I look at you, or I look at my neighbor, or I look at a political figure, or I look at people I would deem wrong, good, bad, and you know who we need to see in all of them? We need to see the image and likeness of who? God. The Bible tells us that when man was created, he was created in the imago Dei, the image and likeness of God. That is to say that man is neither divine nor is man the product of primordial process, right? The goo didn't become a zoo and the zoo didn't become you. Man was created by a direct act of God. Adam's body was created by God from the dust of the earth. His soul was created by the breath of life that was breathed into him, Genesis 2:7. We all, every human being is made by God, because of God, and for God. Every one of us. To be human being, what does it mean to be a human? It is to bear God's image, both body and soul. And as such, being made in the image of God, think about this, that God has uniquely, we take these things for granted, but they are so unique. They only belong to us. And that is that God has given us what we call his communicable attributes, as opposed to his non-communicable attributes. There are some things about God that make God God that he didn't share with us. But there are many things that make God God that he did. We are unique. We are unique. Of all the things that exist in the universe, we are so unique. Think about this. We have, unlike any other thing in the universe, the ability to love. Don't take that for granted. We have a little beautiful gray feral cat that crawls on our porch, has been doing so for 3 years. Bright blue, bright green eyes, long haired gray. She's cute as a button. And she doesn't love us. She uses us. Love. How about justice? How about grace? Mercy. Boy, are these things the world could use a little more of. Goodness, truthfulness, rational thought. I hear a lot of irrational stuff going on. The ability to communicate. The ability to be relational. How about even this, that we are self-conscious? You know, that cat doesn't know she's going to die. I do. That cat has no concept of age or responsibility. You and I are uniquely self-conscious, which is all these things: love, justice, grace, mercy, goodness, truthfulness, rationality, communication, relational, self-conscious. It's all to steer us in a way that honors God as his image bearers. Listen, in the temple, God forbid any images and likeness. Everybody say amen. You will find, not because we're not patriotic or anything, there's no images in here. Or are there? This room is filled with images. You and I are the image of God. That's why there is to be no other images. What is Jesus saying? It's not about paying your taxes. The issue is giving God what you owe to God. And what do we owe God? Everything. Particularly our obedience, our honor, our worship. But to even take it even more defined, more nuanced, as Jesus asked these guys by way of answer, render to God the things of God. He's asking them a question. What does God want from you? What does God want from you concerning me, Jesus is ostensibly saying. And that is, honor my son, isn't he? You're here trying to trap me and kill me and put me away. But what does God want? He wants you to honor me. Jesus said it this way, if you honor me, you honor the Father. What do we owe God? To love the Lord our God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, with all our strength. Would you say this would also be correct? That what do we owe God? To love the Lord Jesus Christ with all our heart, all our soul, all our mind, all our strength. That's what Jesus is saying to these hypocrites. God requires us to love his son, to honor his son, to believe his son, to embrace his son, to follow his son. Coin belongs to Caesar. Give it to Caesar. It's a coin. But you, give yourself to God. That's what the Lord is really after. Let's pray together if we could. Father, even as we bow our heads and hearts before you this Lord's Day, this Mother's Day, help us by your Spirit to answer for ourselves, what does it mean to be a human being? Who am I? What am I? Why am I? Father, the world has bent over backwards to diminish, dismiss, and replace the fact that we are all the image and likeness of God, stamped uniquely with the communicable attributes of God. It's what makes us who we are, God. Father, help us to think about ourselves that way. Help us to think about others that way. And Father, if we thought that way, the problems that are drowning our world and culture and society would go away. They would disappear. Lord, I pray for us today that you would help us to follow Christ, to honor him, to render to God the things that are God's in our life. Our minds, our resources, our talents, our energies, our passions, our affections. Help us to be your people. Help us to live as the image of God in this world. Now, that's what the world needs to see. It's really the only answer. Father, for the person here today who has never trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, I would simply say to you what Jesus said to them, and that is, brother, sister, whoever you are, render to God the things that are God's, which is primarily yourself. To come to Christ in grace and faith, to believe upon him, to confess that as sinners we are marred images of God, but that in Christ we can restore and renew his image, to transform the image of the fallen Adam into the image of his glorious Son. Lord, we thank you for this lesson today. We thank you for the truth. We thank you for the wisdom of Jesus that we see so marvelously on display in this text. We see the foolishness of our world. It's little stupid innuendos and its traps and its unbelief masqueraded as cleverness and erudition and so forth. It's all just dumb. Dumb ways that dumb people try to get away from the truth. And yet, Lord, our world, our culture, you've called us to be lights in a dark world. Help us to do that. Give us boldness, give us wisdom, give us love, give us mercy, give us compassion. And I pray again for our mothers. I pray for Grace Church. Help us to be a force for good in this community, in our world, in our families. We pray these things in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Would you join me as we stand together for the benediction? Again, we read Nicene Creed, a triune creed about God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. In this benediction that I've been pronouncing over you for years and years and years, it is also triune. Listen to the word Lord as you receive it. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you peace. Amen.